This is Inside Texas Politics with Jason Whiteley.
Good morning and welcome to Inside Texas Politics. I'm Jason Whiteley. As we move into 2018, expect the jockeying to begin for the next Speaker of the House. We're a year away from a vote, but Republicans, some of them at least, want the party to have all this decided before it ever gets to the floor. In studio, State Rep Ron Simmons, a Republican from Carrollton, someone often mentioned as a candidate for Speaker, and joining the questioning, as always, Bud Kennedy here of the Star-Telegram. Ron, good to see you.
Hey, thank you for having me. Appreciate it. Happy New Year.
And Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year to you all. 2018, it's hard to believe.
It's already here.
Golly. Yeah.
Do you have aspirations to become Speaker? We've asked you that several times, but the calendar has moved.
The calendar is moving. Yeah. I don't have any particular plans for that. I think a lot of moving parts will come into play between now and this coming November or December, and we'll just have to see how it works out. You know, I'm very happy representing House District 65 and the work that I do on transportation and other things. But we'll have to see how it all works out.
Ron, if you are nominated, will you pursue that?
If I'm nominated, and that's what my caucus members in the body wants me to do, yes, I'd be honored.
Well, now, that pledge process is more than just waiting for a nomination on the floor. And unless there's some sort of turmoil in the caucus, you're really going to go into a closed meeting and choose the next speaker without the public seeing the process. Isn't that right?
Well, what we're going to do is we're going to do like 40 other states do, and we're going to go in and we're going to have a caucus meeting, as the Democrats will as well. And through that caucus meeting, we're going to select our nominee that will have gotten at least 60%, maybe two-thirds of the vote, because we're not going to leave there. It's a little bit like the conclave, right? We're not going to leave there until somebody has at least 60% of our caucus vote. And that, and then everyone else, we believe, will follow that onto the House floor. And hopefully the reasonable-minded Democrats will as well.
And if a Republican doesn't follow that, what is the punishment?
There is no punishment. The punishment happens at the ballot box, if there is punishment at all.
Well, let's talk about that, because, you know, wrangling some Republicans to make sure they vote in lockstep with the caucus, I've heard from some who say, you know, they're not going to do that.
And there probably are. There'd be a lot of people in the public like to know those names if you'd care to list those out later.
Well, that'll be public record, obviously, when they vote.
But I think what will happen is, I think between now and then, I think the grassroots organizations and the Republican clubs will be asking that question of every candidate, and they'll need to go on record as to what they feel about that. And for some people, it may not make a difference for them.
And Representative, you mentioned that'll be decided at the ballot box if someone doesn't vote that way. Do you think the party, or do you think someone will actively campaign against those who don't vote in lockstep with the caucus?
Oh, I think that there will be some people in their districts that would say, hey, we don't agree with this. We think you should support. Otherwise, that's why you're a Republican.
They might mount a challenge against the
incumbent. I think that could absolutely happen. No question about it.
You know, what do you think will be the at play in the next legislature? Obviously, Hurricane Harvey's still going to be weighing heavy on the budget. What are the big issues that people should be asking candidates about now as the races for the primary heat up?
Well, Harvey will be take a lot of air out of the room for sure, no question about that. We'll have to make some decisions on rainy day fund, things like that, because some of the agency's budgets have been depleted because of that. But I think also we'll follow up on our CPS reform that we did to make sure that's working right. Any tweaks need to go to that. Transportation is going to continue to be a big issue. As you know, this week, or here in the last couple of weeks, TxDOT has had to remove all of their plans on how they were going to do a bunch of toll road for these big projects. And shame on them for going down that road as aggressively as they did. If they would have followed the statute of the bill that I passed two sessions ago, we wouldn't be in this problem right now.
The education and business lobby at least making noises saying they're going to come after some of the more conservative members and try to bring the House back to the mainstream. Is that a good idea for them?
Well, I think that what the business lobby is talking about, those two separately, what the business lobby needs to follow is who is pro-business, okay? Who is making good decisions on low taxes, low regulations, things like that? And I think that most Republicans
will follow that. Bathrooms is the issue businesses are concerned about, and you're not on their side on that issue.
Well, my issue, the bill that I had, as you know, was a compromise bill, very much so, yeah. And it had no effect on private business whatsoever. But who knows if that issue will still be there in 2019.
Representative, let's dig back into TxDOT. You mentioned there, too. Voters told TxDOT no new toll roads. TxDOT does an accounting trick to kind of get around that until state lawmakers and the governor and lieutenant governor said, no new toll roads at all. Do you think TxDOT needs new leadership?
Well, that's a good question, and let me answer it this way, because I've been on the Transportation Committee for the last two terms. I chaired a subcommittee on long-term planning, and what I think TxDOT needs to do is they need to be agnostic on how roads are funded. That's not their role. Their role is to prioritize the projects around the state and then for the legislature and the governor to help decide, okay, how's the money going to be allocated? We put in a process. They disregarded that process. What they're trying to do is be all things to all people, and the utilization of toll roads, yes, it will make it go faster, but the governor has said and the people have said, look, we've given you this extra money. We want you to try to do as much as you can without any types of toll roads.
And it looks like TxDOT deliberately ignored that and still went around what lawmakers and what voters said. What should happen?
Very concerned about that. I think the TxDOT needs to be examined from the leadership all the way from the commission all the way down through the leadership and to be examined as to how they came up with that decision. Now, I think they were trying to do anything nefarious? No, I think they were trying to build as many roads as they could and saying, hey, this is the only way we can do it, but they evidently didn't hear the message of how the money's supposed to be spent.
Ron, I want to ask you one political question. You're very close to Faith and Values Conservatives in Texas. There is a candidate challenging Ted Cruz, Bruce Jacobson, Faith and Values Conservative, who's supported by Governor Huckabee. Do you think he'll make that a race?
No, I do not. I think Senator Cruz will, while he will have to come back and win some hearts and minds from people after the presidential election, I think he will win that going away.
Gotcha. Rod Simmons, Republican from Carrollton. Thanks for being here and Happy New Year to you.
Thank you for having me. Happy New Year to y'all too. I really appreciate it.
We appreciate it.